Everybody knows what a placebo is, right? Right. So that's where somebody, usually a sneaky doctor, tricks you into feeling better or more vital by handing you a sugar pill and telling you that it's powerful medicine. So the question that I have for you is, what if you didn't need to be tricked? What if you could do that for yourself just by pretending really hard? Okay. So grown-ups don't talk about pretending very much. We have more dignified words for it, like theorizing and counterfactual, right? But I like to think about pretending, and in fact, there was a whole branch of psychology a long time ago that was devoted to pretending. And I can say it's the lost science because the word that describes it is now one of the 10 most obscure words in the English language, according to Webster's Dictionary. And here it is, cognition. Raise your hand if you've ever heard of this word. Unless you've been to my website, you probably haven't. Right? Cognition, from the Latin cognatio, an attempting from cognare to try, the part of mental life having to do with striving, including desire and volition, to be distinguished from cognition and emotion. So notice that this contains a counterfactual, it contains things that are not currently true, but you want them to be. Okay? So I like thinking about pretending because I think it's very useful. And I think it helps me understand a real puzzle about humans, something that's been bothering me for as long as I can remember, which is that we're really good at not learning. We're really good at rejecting information, and it's baffling because you would think that if you were building an optimum brain, an optimum learning machine, that it would be sucking the information that it could get from anywhere and just like piling it on and getting it from wherever it could get it. But that's not what happens. We actually reject a lot of what the world offers us to make us function better on purpose. And this is really mystifying, and it's a bitter pill for scientists, let me tell you. So we want to be objective, and we want the truth. And most of us are scientists in one way or another, even if we don't identify that way. So understanding why people are such bad learners in many ways keeps my lab busy. There's a team of really smart and very dedicated scientists working on this problem, maybe right this minute, over in my lab right now, I hope, on Saturday morning, to understand, excuse me, to understand intrinsic motivation, like curiosity and how it impacts learning, and extrinsic incentives, external incentives, like rewards and punishment, and how they affect learning. So, to help think about this, I'd like to invite you to consider that again and again, the message that we get is that it's not enough to understand the external incentive. It's not enough to say we offered somebody a $10 reward or threatened them. You have to understand how the brain responds to that reward to that person at that moment to know how it's going to affect behavior. So let's have some audience participation to get a feel for this, okay? I'd like you to anticipate the reward. I'm going to show you an image in a few moments. And it's going to be a rich image, very colorful and full of story and sensory detail, and invite anticipation and predictions of on its own. And so conjure an image of what you think I'm going to show you. In a moment. Okay. So it's really easy to see why an image like this invokes a lot of brain activity distributed throughout the brain. It's got lots of sensory information, colors, inviting, storytelling, but this is what we see. We see a brain that looks like a sunset. We use imaging to document these responses. This is a functional magnetic resonance imaging technique that shows the brain activity indirectly based on the blood oxygenation levels, okay? So we can see these really rich images driving a lot of brain activity throughout the brain, but this image was actually created after somebody saw this. Okay? So how is it that this really impoverished, simple little circle can make a brain that looks like a sunset? All of these things are happening. So to understand that, you need to know two things about this circle. And one is that it means something, right? For the people in our studies, it means that they're about to have an opportunity to earn a reward. If they hit a button fast enough, they get $4. So it means something that's bigger than what it looks like. And the second thing is that the activation that it generates is in a part of the brain, a very special part of the brain, called midbrain, that contains neurons that release dopamine throughout the brain. So those neurons are special because they take information from all across the brain, many different brain regions, old and new, limbic and cortical, and integrate it into a simple signal that then is broadcast throughout the brain to affect brain function simultaneously and synergistically. And in all these places affects learning and memory and motor action and action selection and even volition, okay? So I'd like to give you a feel for this experimentally. This looks a little detailed and dry, but stick with it because I think it's relevant to many of your lives, right? To study how these external incentives impact things like learning, we have very simple little games that we create. So we ask people to hit a button anytime they see an image. Here it's flashing, 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 turn black and white, okay? Very simple. Some of the people in this study earn money for being fast enough, and others avoid a static electric shock. It's quite unpleasant, but it doesn't hurt. So for all of these people, once in a while, they're doing their job waiting for the thing to turn black and white. Once in a while, a surprise happens. It's a small surprise. But if it's a violation of predictions, it's something that you should learn about because what you were expecting didn't happen, right? So what we see is that that learning is different, whether you're working to avoid a punishment or working to earn a reward, okay? The brain response to that little surprise happens in different parts of memory systems. So if you're in the punishment group, I'll start with the reward. If you're in the rewards group, because it's on the left, it'll be the left way. Expectations and violations, right? So if you're in the reward group, your brain responds to that little surprise in the hippocampus, which is a specialized memory structure, purpose-built. And if you're in the punishment group, you get a response to that little surprise in the overlying cortex. So these are not regions for processing rewards and punishments. These are memory machines doing their job in the same way, in the same task, and all that's different is the incentive structure. Okay? So what that means, why that matters, is that these regions do really different things and make different kinds of memories. So the overlying cortex extracts the features, but you need the hippocampus to bind them together into something complex that you can manipulate and play with. So if we then ask people with a question like this, which one of these things did you see? The people in the reward group get a benefit for their incentive, and the people in the punishment group do not. So I wish I could tell you, let's back up a second. I wish I could tell you that that meant that all you need to do is pepper rewards through your learning and reward each other and reward yourselves and everything will be great. But we are so perverse that even rewards can get turned into punishments. If we look at stress responses in the brain and on the skin in this task and other tasks, there are some people at some time when you respond to the reward cue that you show them with a stress response. And guess whether those people get the benefit from the reward cue? You're among us. We are them. We don't know whether this is a time of day thing, a time of study thing, or an individual differences thing, because it's hard to reproduce this on an ongoing basis, on repeated trials. But it certainly happens robustly and continuously. So, once again, it's not enough to just stick an incentive in front of somebody. You have to know how the brain responds to it. But it certainly is safe to say that this kind of fear-based strategy, making your high-stakes testing even more high-stakes by tying them to your life, is probably a bad idea for most of the learning that you want to do. Okay? So then what are we to do? If we can't use money because it's nice because you can count it and hand it to people, but it's really unreliable. And in fact, it can undercut intrinsic motivation and curiosity in the on the more fun kinds of engaging with your material. How are we to engage people and get them to learn better? So this is where things got really interesting for us in my lab. We started thinking about whether we could get people to do this for themselves. We've been using these incentives to drive dopamine and other modulatory brain regions that fertilize things and make them happen. What if we could just ask people to do what they usually do? And the more we thought about this, the more sense it made, because for us, we could get away with cheaper experiments by not having to pay people all the time, but also, it was something that people really seemed to do on a regular basis. They motivate themselves and set themselves up and do the things that they need to do, and it really hadn't been understood in any deep way or any biological way. So we decided to give it a try. We put people in the scanner, and we asked them to conjure up motivating thoughts and imagery. There he is. And we watched what happened in the midbrain. The first really basic question that we had was, would these thoughts and images that they conjured up actually drive midbrain dopamine? I thought it would. What do you think? Yes? No? Yes? Well, sadly, no. So, sadly, people weren't able to walk in and do it on their own, so we decided the next thing we would try to do is to train them to do it with some help. And because we were interested in activating these brain systems, the most direct way to do it was to give them feedback about what their brain was doing, right? Not about what we thought should be happening, but actual feedback from the midbrain where the dopamine neurons live. So they watched a thermometer go up and down. Because we're scientists and we control things, we had some other things happening, like a rest condition where things fluctuated like a metronome up and down really systematically, but provided no information and counting backwards. So under these conditions, we did see midbrain activation, but we expected that because we know that the dopamine system responds to feedback. Okay? So the critical test was what happened next when we took the feedback away. So when we took the feedback away and asked people to just recreate, I'm not sure this is going to stick, ask people to recreate the strategies that worked best when they were training, once again, they activated their midbrain on purpose with no help from us, no rewards, no reinforcement, no feedback. Here are the kinds of things that they reported doing. My daughter might win the lottery, queen songs, mental imagery of success, like standing on the top of the cliffs when you climbed there, phrases like, you can do it, go get it, and my favorite, running down the line where thousands of people are giving you high fives. All right, so this is the imagery that they used, and they created this brain state, right? So here's the development of this activation over the course of training. So the blue group is the people that got the metronome stimulus, and the orange group are the people that got valid feedback about what their thoughts and images were doing to their midbrain. So during training, we see it develop, and we take the training feedback stimulus away, and it's actually even more robust. People are sitting there thinking, driving their neurochemistry. So if thoughts and imagery can change these brain circuits just by doing this special kind of pretending, that breaks the spell, and you can cast your own placebo spell without being tricked, right? Manipulate these systems using this special kind of pretending. And because these systems are so linked to learning and action and invigoration, the pretending that you do will change your brain not just now, not just today, but tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow. So what I'd like you to remember is that the world inside your head is the real world, and it's not true, and it can be useful. Because it's linked to action and learning, by pretending to invoke the state of motivation and the brain state that's associated with it, you can learn to make your real world more true, and act to bring other worlds closer to your own.